A.D. 64. He had just turned 64. The irony was not lost on him. The great fire of Rome, started by the Emperor Nero, forced the Roman Senate to fund his elaborate building projects. Nero concocted a scheme to blame the fire on a new church in town, a church unlike the rest of the churches, a church whose members believed that God had lived, God had died, and now God lived again. One of their leaders, a man by the name of Paul, had been arrested and brought to Rome for trial. What the church did not know is that Nero had concocted a plan to make Paul the scapegoat for the fire that he started. Yes, sir. Paul, however, I believe, had been told by God that this is exactly what would happen. Yes, sir. And so Paul, writing from a dreary, damp, dank dungeon cell in Rome, waiting to be beheaded by an executioner's axe blade out on the Appian Way just outside of the city, writes to a young man whom he knew, a young man whom he loved, a young man he had mentored. And that young man's name was Timothy. And we can read what Paul wrote to Pastor Timothy in his second letter to him, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Paul tells Timothy, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Paul was prepared to die. My question to you this morning is, are you? Are you ready to die? If not, then you need to be. And the Bible says the individual who is ready to die knows something. And what they know is that they know that to God Himself they have been faithful. That man, that woman, that youth, that young adult, that child knows that they have been faithful to God. They know that they have been faithful in many areas in their lives. And today I just want to key in on a couple. They know that they have been faithful in that they have obeyed the gospel. In verses 6 and 7 of 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul tells Timothy, "I am already being poured out." He was already in process. Please know, we are already in process. From the moment that we are born, we are headed toward death. It is an inevitability of the human experience. Oh, there are some rare occasions that are listed for us in the scriptures where there are those that escape the experience. You can read all about that, but that is not the norm. But in Paul's case, that's not what he's talking about. He's saying, I know that from the perspective of an outside looking world, my demise is going to come earlier than expected. But not to Paul, because he was prepared for it whenever it came. He says, I am already being interesting imagery. I'll speak to this in a moment. Being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. Look what he says there. In the New Living Translation, Paul states it clearly, the time of my death is near. Paul tells Timothy that he is being poured out like a drink offering. This is one word in the Greek. It is the word spendomai. It means being poured out as a libation. It's an act of worship. And Timothy would have fully understood this. Paul is literally telling him, I am devoting myself to my death. You say, why in the world at 11:28 on a Sunday morning when everything is going on in my life and in the world that I live in, would you come in here with this Debbie Downer?
Come on, sir, bring it down.
Stick around, I got something for you. Paul has prepared himself for this day. How do we know that? It's because he tells us so. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 23, he uses the very same verbiage that he uses in today's text. Paul told the Philippian church, even if I, watch this, am being poured out like a drink offering, spendomai, on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. Paul echoes the words of 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22, which was later set to song by the late, great Keith Green. Keith wrote, to obey is better than sacrifice. I don't need your money, I want your life, says God. And I hear you say that I'm coming back soon, but you act like I'll never return.
Come on, sir, teach.
To obey is better than sacrifice. I want more than Sundays and Wednesday nights, because if you can't come to me every day, then don't bother coming at all. When you obey the call of the gospel, let us demystify that term. The word gospel in the Greek is the word euangelion. It is transliterated, kicking and screaming, into the English language called the evangel. It literally means the good news, the great news. What news? The news that there is a love in heaven that has your name on it. There is a God that looked down and realized that in a world that had concocted something called religion, where we seek to better ourselves and seek to better one another, and we seek to make some sense of it all, we seek to get to God, God realizing none of us could ever do that, and that we would live our lives in the tyranny of fear, in the tyranny of doubt, in the tyranny of never knowing what is enough to earn God's love and have a home in a place called heaven. Look down, and God the Father looked at his son and said, and his son said, I'm way ahead of you, Dad. And he headed down, and he was born. He put on a human flesh. As it says literally in the Greek, he pitched his tent with us a while. Romans chapter 1. Became one of us, Emmanuel. Grew up as one of us, came into our lives, experienced what we experience, lived a life of sinlessness. Why? So he could be so good? No, because he knows we're not.
Yes, sir.
And then upon the cross, he died. He took our place because we are deserving of death. We are deserving of punishment. All of that from God. Why? Because we have sinned. We mess up. And sin is not just the bad things we do or say, or the bad attitudes we have. It's when at some point in our lives, whether we say it verbally or we do it through actions or attitude, we say, you know what, I won't be the boss. I want to be in charge. I ain't listening to nobody. I'm going to run my own life. And God, I'm going to be my own God. And God says, you go right ahead. And what that does is that it severs the cord between us and him. And death sets in. And we die from the inside out. Every day we die a little bit more. And so when we obey the gospel, the good news, what we're saying is that we have accepted Jesus as our Savior. We realize that religion will not get the job done. Only a relationship will. And we are obedient to not only receiving it for ourselves, but making sure that others receive it as well. When you obey the call of the gospel, that means God's speaking to you. And I came today to proclaim to you, every one of us is called. Every one of us is called into the ministry. How do I know that? Because the Bible says so. Let you in on a little secret. Every one of you are ministers. Every one of you are preachers. Every one of you got a pulpit. It just may be in different places before different audiences. There are people that you will stand before I will never be able to preach to because God specifically placed them in your path for you to do it. And when we obey the call of the gospel, when we obey the command to come to Christ, follow Christ, share Christ, when we do all of that, our obedience, hear me now, is rewarded. Rewarded. One of your rewards is the absolute assurance that when you take your last breath on this side of eternity, you take your next upstairs. The last breath you take here, your next breath is in the hereafter. Now, for some of you that may be young and spry and feel good all the time, that may not mean like much. But there's some in this room and some that are watching this today. That's not their story. I read a book several years ago by Howard Napier entitled Come Sweet Death. There are some that look at death as a welcome guest, a rescuer because of the pain they go through, because of, can I say this, the hell they go through. And some of you are in this room, aren't you? And to know that if I keep the faith, if I stay the course, if I obey my Jesus, a day is coming because Jesus told me in John 14, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am in heaven, there you may be also. He's getting our room ready.
Yes, he is. Hallelujah.
And it is designed with us in mind. I came today to tell you, your room won't look like mine. And mine won't look like yours. But thanks be to God, we got a room upstairs. And I've met people over the years that they hold on to that with a bulldogged tenacity because it's the only thing that gets them through. Is that you today? Touch your neighbor and say, hold on, baby, hold on.
Hold on, baby, hold on. Glory to God.
Paul knew that. He knew that his last breath here would be followed by his next breath in heaven. Paul knew that, and now so do you.
Yes.
The person who, like Paul, who is prepared to die, has also been faithful in that number two in your study guide. They have followed Jesus. They have followed Jesus. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, the 7th verse, Paul writes, I have fought the good fight. And he had. On behalf of the body of Christ, on behalf of the kingdom, on behalf of our Lord, I want to apologize publicly for those who may have looked at you and said, come to Jesus, you will live an easy life.
Please forgive us. Yes, yes.
I have talked to some of you in this room who have gotten really radical and sold out for Jesus, and all hell has busted loose in your life, hasn't it? And I've looked at some of you and asked you the question, man, you have really, and I won't use the term I've used with you privately, but I've said, man, you have really ticked the devil off, haven't you? Good for you.
Amen.
Make him mad. Do you know what? There comes a point in time where he pushes and pushes and pushes, and if you will rise yourself up and say, bring it on. You bring everything you and your demons and hell have to offer, because when all else has failed, I'm going to stand. I will take everything you want to bring my way. afflict me, cut me down, break me, I'm going to stand. And when I stand, you can't do nothing but run. Can't do nothing but run. Run, devil, run. Thank you. I feel my helper showed up. I have fought the good fight. It is a fight. It is a fight. Every day is a declaration of war. Yes, it is. Yes. So you got to fight. And sometimes fighting ain't pretty. Come on. And sometimes people will watch you fight, and it don't look so good. It's not like you got a ringside seat watching somebody that's a professional in the ring. We're still learning as we go. But you got to fight. You got to fight with everything you got and fight with everything you know. And I don't know about you, but if I was taking on an enemy like the devil, I'd want to get some training for the ring. And that's why you're in here. And that's why you need to get into your word. That's why you need to get into a Bible study class. That's why you need to be discipled. That's why you got to get whatever you can get, wherever you can get it, every time you can get it. Let the church say amen. I have fought the good fight, and he says, I have finished the race. Ronnie Lott is perhaps, I believe, the greatest safety ever to play the game of football. Did you realize that in one Super Bowl with the San Francisco 49ers, he damaged his pinky? And so rather than come out of the game, he asked the trainers, and when the trainers wouldn't, if you have ever seen any footage on Ronnie Lott, he's rather convincing. Yes, sir. He said, do it. And they cut the end of his finger off, wrapped it up. He played the rest of the game, and oh, what a game he played. Oh. And when they interviewed him in the locker room after the game, he was talking to his team. And he said, today, and they won, by the way. He said, today, we left it all on the field. We got nothing left. And then he looked at him and said, but doesn't it feel good?
Yeah.
Doesn't it feel good? Listen, church, we got to leave it all on the field.
Yes, sir.
When we go home to heaven, we don't need to leave anything undone here.
Amen.
Absolutely nothing. I meet so many people that have said, well, I should have done that, and I should have done this, and I should have done the other. Let me proclaim to you, you've should all over yourself.
Come on, man. Come on. They should have. Come on. Mm-hmm. All over themselves.
You make of that anything you want.
Help me, Jesus.
So instead of should have, would have, had about, could have, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Let's leave nothing undone.
Yes,
so that when we come to the end of our days, whenever it is, we can say, I fought the good fight. I put it all on the field. And the only thing I'm taking with me are the blessings of God and all of the people I've led to Jesus. And when I get upstairs, they're going to meet me at the gate. I don't want to be walking through heaven's gate by myself. About you, but I want a crowd there to greet me. You talk about crowns? The only crowns I want are for those that will look at me and say, you probably don't even know me, but I'm here because of you.
Amen.
And then I'm going to walk in and take them right up to Jesus and say, Lord, I present to you my crowns. Paul said, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. And look, he says, I have kept the faith.
Yes, sir.
In the face of seemingly insurmountable obstacles, Paul had done just that. That Paul had followed Jesus was an absolute, undeniable fact. If you'll allow me to teach for just a little while, Herbert Workman, in his book, Persecution in the Early Church, tells us that in the 4th century, Diocletian, the Roman emperor, carried out one of the most severe persecutions empire-wide of the Christian church. Diocletian's son-in-law, Galerius, urged him to begin the persecutions, and then he insisted that they continue. Succeeding Diocletian as emperor of Rome, Galerius continued the persecutions with unabated zeal. Diocletian had his home in a place called Nicomedia. A young Roman officer who was a part of the army and the court of Galerius was impressed by the faith of these Christians in Nicomedia. Every day, these Christians in Nicomedia were being put to death. And so he asked a group of them prior to them being put to death, he asked them, what was the secret of their courage in the face of persecution? How can you be so brave? Looking at all that you know, watching them die, knowing that you're next. And they introduced him to someone named Jesus and said, it is because of him, and it is because of who he is and what he's done. It's because of who we are in him. It's because he was raised up out of the grave, and because he was raised up out of the grave, I'm going to walk out too. And death has no power. Death does not get the final word. And Galerius accepted, this army officer in Galerius' army accepted Christ. History tells us that when the Christians were next examined, this Roman officer stepped forward and requested Galerius to make a note of the fact that he was being numbered among the Christians. Galerius asked, are you mad? Have you lost your mind? Do you wish to throw your life away? He replied with a smile upon his face, I am not mad. I was mad once, but now I am in my right mind. This young Roman army officer was won to Christ. Watch this now. Because of the way he watched Christians die. Following Jesus is not a one-time thing. Following Jesus is not the end of the Christian life. It is the beginning. Day in, day out, 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, 1,440 minutes every day, 86,400 seconds of every day, we are called to follow Christ. We are called to follow Christ when we are up. And we are called to follow Christ when we are down. We are called to follow Christ when things are going great, and we are called to follow Christ when the bottom falls out. The follower of Jesus is commanded, watch this, to be faithful. Consistently faithful. This faithfulness rewards the faithful by assuring them that in the face of the pallid specter of death, they are more than ready for it. That person who has been faithful and has faithfully followed Jesus is that person who is prepared to die. The individual who has obeyed the gospel and who has followed Jesus has also been faithful in that, number three on your study guide, they have occupied for Jesus. Folks, sometimes you just got to show up. We speak so much about doing when sometimes we need to just be. Yes, sir. There is a ministry of presence we need to have in life. Some of the most profound people I've ever met never said a word to me. But I watched. I observed. I saw how they lived. I saw how they responded. And how they did it day in and day out, day in and day out. You know, folks, the beginning is really great, and sometimes the end is really exciting, but it's that middle part that, can I say this, really sucks. See, we can get in a worship setting like this, and we can, as my grandma used to say, whoop it up. And it is great. And it's real great. We can take it home, and it's great even Sunday afternoon. There's somewhere about Tuesday at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It's, where'd Sunday go? Where'd all that go? Am I making sense?
Yes, sir.
So the point being, as the Bible says, sometimes you just got to stir yourself up. If there's not somebody around you to stir you up, you just got to stir yourself up. You got to put on your own praise. You don't put it on for some, you don't have somebody else put it on you. Listen, we're not children. We're adults in the faith. You don't need somebody dressing you anymore. Also, you don't need anybody spoon feeding you anymore. You need to feed yourself. And you need to get on to some steak. I can't tell you how many times over the years I have wanted to share so many things God's told me and he said to me. And I don't mean this as an insult. I take responsibility for it, that maybe I failed you in this way. But he's told me, don't tell them. They're not ready for that. You don't know what I go out of here with. Going, gosh, I just wish. So got to grow. Got to grow. And that growth comes day in and day out. 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 Whatever sport you may have an affinity for, be it the World Cup in soccer, be it the Super Bowl, be it the World Series, be it whatever it may be, NBA championships, what have you, those individuals do not win on the court because they just showed up on the day of the game and played.
All right.
I played high school football back when dinosaurs roamed the earth. And we used to have something called two-a-day practices in August. Some of you know what I'm talking about? You practiced in the morning for 4 hours, you took a lunch break, and then you came back and practiced for 4 more hours in the late afternoon into the evening, and you did it at least 2 weeks in a row. I went to Elkton High School. We did it for a month. We spent an entire month before the start of the season. Why? Because we would be ready. And when we took the field and others weren't ready, we imposed, watch this, our will upon them. God's calling us day in, day out. Train, 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 train. Pray, study your Bible, grow in your faith. Serve, 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 serve. And then when the crisis comes, you just walk right on through it.
Yes, sir. Come on, Pastor. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, if you were at the early service and you're saying, well, he didn't say that at the early hour, you're going to have to blame the Holy Ghost for that. I'm just sharing what he gives me. Occupied. In my 35 years in the pastorate, I've been blessed to meet, get to know, and minister to countless persons to whom life had dealt them, how shall we say this, a difficult hand of cards. Some had physical challenges, some had psychological challenges, some had developmental challenges. Some suffered from emotional illnesses, and some suffered from chronic pain. Some had special needs, some had gone through so much hell here on earth, it was an absolute miracle that they were still numbered among the living. Some have been members of the churches where I've served. Some I've met on mission trips. Some I saw in hospitals. Some I've served on staff with. And some I've been honored to officiate their funerals. And there is one reoccurring quality seen in each and every one of their lives, and it is this. While they could have resigned themselves to lives of angry misery, and had they done that, no one would have blamed them. But rather than resign themselves to live and lead lives of angry misery, they allowed God to transform their misery into their ministry. And who they were spoke volumes more than anything they could ever say. Their identity in Christ transformed their ministry for Christ as they entered into their destiny with Christ. I know it's 11:52, but I got to give that one to you again. Their identity in Christ transformed their ministry for Christ as they entered into their destiny with Christ. Rather than shirk their duties, they stepped up and they stepped out and they refused to yield their spot. Every one of us has got a spot. You got a spot, I got a spot, all God's children got a spot. It's the place we occupy. Can you give me two more seconds to teach? I want to teach you a Greek word today. It's peripateo. Say it with me. Peripateo. What it means is, this is where God has told you to occupy, and you walk in it. You walk in it. No, you don't walk outside of it. That's for somebody else. Listen, too many of us are worried about how somebody else is walking, what they're doing, how they're conducting. We need just to keep walking and just keep walking, keep being obedient. And you say, well, what about them? God will deal with them. You just keep on walking. You just keep on walking. You just keep on walking until he says, I want you to walk someplace else. And then you step over here and you walk in that. And you step over here and you walk in that. And you keep walking until the day you walk right into the throne room of God at the end of your days in a place called glory. Am I making sense here? You need to chew on that a little bit, but that's God's truth. Each one of them refused to yield their spot. When you've done everything to stand, just stand. I can't do anything about it, just stand. I can't change it, stand. I can't make it any better. Stand. But you don't know what they... Stand. But, Pastor, you don't... Stand. Yeah. But you don't understand the pain I'm in. Stand. Stand. Don't yield your spot.
Don't give up your spot. Amen.
And God will bless you. Amen. God will reward you. Rather than yield their spot to pain... problems. Instead, they faithfully occupied all those that I've known throughout these 35 years. They faithfully occupied their particular spot on this planet for none other than Jesus. This is why I believe so many of them lived their lives and joyfully went to their deaths, echoing the words of Paul who said in verse 8 today, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness. Hear me, please. You want a crown? You got to wear a cross. You want resurrection, you got to go through crucifixion.
Come on, sir.
There is no shortcut. One of the concepts of Christianity that is not talked about, Teresa, you and I were talking about this the other day. We don't talk enough about the biblical concept of Christ's call to suffering. Dietrich Bonhoeffer in his book, The Cost of Discipleship, said that when Christ bids a man to come and follow him, he bids him to come and suffer and die. We don't like suffering. We want blessings. I want blessings too. But there's a call to suffering. Why? Because others see more in our suffering than they do in our success. And if they see in our success and they're blessed, that's wonderful. But it's like eating cotton candy. Sweet to the taste, no substance. But if they see how we weather the storm, they see how we suffer through. They hold on. They hold on. Haven't we said that? You know I got it bad. I talk to some of you when you're going through a tough time. You say, I know I got it bad, but look at so-and-so over there. Look at how they're hanging on. And if they're hanging on, I can hang on too. They lived their lives and joyfully went to their deaths, echoing, now in store for me the crown of righteousness, Paul said, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. I'm so glad that's not where the verse ends. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. It wasn't just for Paul. Say this with me. It wasn't just for Paul. It's for me. It wasn't just for Paul. It's for me. We who have walked this difficult earthly pilgrimage, we who have refused to release our spot to neither our circumstances nor our situations, instead we have faithfully occupied for Jesus, and God, who is faithful, will reward us for that. Will reward us for that. Today, we have learned that the individual who is ready to die knows that they have been faithful to Jesus. They know that they have obeyed Jesus. They know that they have followed Jesus. They know that they have occupied for Jesus. My question for you today is this: do you share this same confidence when it comes to your own mortality? I do not understand for the life of me why it is we make preparations for everything but death. There are people that take out life insurance policies and have never thought about their own demise. Come on, sir. Now, Jesus is coming again. I say, come quickly. But it just may be that we will die before he comes. So are you ready for that day? Have you been faithful? Have you obeyed the gospel? Have you faithfully followed Jesus? Have you, through your identity, your ministry, and your destiny, occupied your place on this planet for Christ? Are you ready? Are you ready to die? Dr. King said it best. He said, that man, that woman who is not prepared to die ain't fit to live.
Yes, sir.
Until you found something that's worth dying for, you're not ready to live, because once you get to the point where you no longer fear death, when you get to the point where you look death in the face and say, ha, bring it on.
Yes, sir.
When you get to that point, you can then have the fear removed, and then you can step out saying, I got nothing to lose. I got everything to gain. I'm going to live, and I'm not going to die, because that's already been done. I died on the cross. I was raised out of the grave. I'm alive. Death can't touch me. I'm going to step out. I'm going to live my life. I'm walking on. Are you there today? And if you're not,